Hello everyone, this is Dr. Dandekar. Let us continue our topic of carcinoma of prostate. In last session, we have discussed etiopathology, clinical presentation, TNM staging, and investigations related to the diagnosis of carcinoma of prostate. In this session, we will discuss the management of CA prostate. Let us first consider the management of localized or early carcinoma of prostate. This localized or early carcinoma of prostate includes stage 1 and 2, or you can say T1A, B, C, T2A and B. Let us see the management outline step by step. Out of the T1 and T2, let us consider the patient who have undergone TURP for BPH, but the histopathology report turned out to be adenocarcinoma. They will have T staging of T1A or T2B. T1A, where the percentage of malignant cells will be less than 5%, and T1B, in which the percentage of malignant cell is more than 5%. All you have to do is to put these patients under strict surveillance and follow them up for 3 months. At every visit, perform DRE, TRUS and estimation of PSA. If you notice the progress, that is recurrence in the form of appearance of lesion on DRE, TRUS or rise in the level of PSA, then consider this patient for radical prostatectomy or radiation. If there is no progress, that is DRE and TRUS are normal and PSA levels within normal limit, continue the surveillance with DRE, TRUS and PSA estimation. The conservative treatment continues as long as these parameters remain normal. If at any point, if the patient shows recurrence, then this patient shall need radical prostatectomy or radiation. Fortunately, the long-term survival in this case with judicious treatment will be 80 to 90%, with mortality rate less than 10%. Next set of patient with early localized carcinoma of prostate will be T1C with increased PSA levels, or T2A or T2B. T2A, where the lesion is confined to one side within the capsule, and T2B, where the lesion occupy both sides of prostate but confined within capsule. The treatment advised may be radical prostatectomy or radiation. Radical prostatectomy. This is a major surgery and calls an experienced surgeon, because sometimes it can be morbid and difficult to perform with possible complications. Now, which patients are indicated for the radical prostatectomy? Patients with T1A, B, C and T2 disease who are young and fit, with a life expectancy more than 10 years. Make sure that there is no evidence of metastasis, which has to prove on the with the presentation of a negative bone scan as well as the normal X-ray chest. Something about this radical prostatectomy. The first radical perineal prostatectomy was performed by Hugh Hampton in 1904, and Millin first described the radical retropubic approach in 1945. This procedure remained unpopular because of the frequent complication of incontinence and impotence. After 1980, with improved understanding of pelvic pathology and improved surgical technique, the radical prostatectomy regain its place as a curative treatment. Laparoscopic and robotic approach have further reduced the complication rate, though these techniques are costly and available at only select centers. Patients with organ-confined cancer have 10-year disease-free survival ranging from 70 to 85%. The associated intraoperative and post-op complications are listed here, and they are hemorrhage, injuries to the obturator nerve, ureter or rectum. Patient can have deep vein thrombosis, may land up in a pulmonary embolism, may have lymphocele, infections are also common, and these are the problematic. Last two are the problems which have condemned this procedure of incontinence as well as those patients who are not fit for surgery or not opting for surgery can be posted for the radiation treatment. Radiation treatment can be given by two methods. First is generalized external beam radiotherapy, that is also called as a XRT, and second is more localized, that is brachytherapy. This traditional external beam radiotherapy can be used to give a safe delivery of 6,500 to 7,000 centigrade units of the radiation to the prostate. Brachytherapy can be given with the help of TRUS and the computer guidance, by which the radioactive seeds or the implants which contain the iodine-125 or palladium-103 are placed into the prostate. These seeds are of two types. Few seeds which are permanent, that means once they are placed, they are left inside, or some of the seeds are wire operated, which can be removed once their role is over. The advantage of brachytherapy is that it limits the radiation only to the prostate, and the surrounding structures or organs are spared. The radiation treatment results are comparable to the surgery, has less complication and less morbidity. This is a schematic representation of the external beam radiotherapy or XRT unit. In our institute, we have a similar unit which you can visit anytime by visiting our basement. And this is a schematic representation of a complicated brachytherapy, and you can see the mechanism which is required for placement of the implants or seed. Radiation treatment avoids surgery, which is the biggest advantage, but it also has disadvantages and the limitation. It needs a very costly and specialized radiotherapy unit, as well as availability of radioisotopes. The treatment duration runs for a long time. It takes almost 4 to 6 weeks, in which the patient must show compliance and attend all the radiation sittings. The complications which are associated with the external beam radiotherapy are: they can cause bladder irritation, urinary urgency, incontinence, rectal irritation, diarrhea, proctitis, and may cause erectile dysfunction. Now, let us see the treatment plan for a patient who present with a locally advanced CA prostate, that is T3 and T4. Here you can see T3 onward. Here the aim of treatment is to control the growth and spread of disease. Thus the aim is palliative more than curative. In this, surgery is not possible and also not recommended because of the advanced disease or metastasis. Such a patient may be given radiation therapy in the form of external beam radiotherapy, but the important addition to the radiation is androgen deprivation. Now, what is this androgen deprivation and what is its importance? In pathogenesis, we have learned that CA prostate occurs in the active prostate cells, and its growth as well as spread is directly related to presence of testosterone hormone secreted by the lytic cells of testes. If you block this testosterone, then the rate of growth and the rate of spread will be reduced, thereby keeping the disease in control. Now, the question is, how do you decrease or how do you manage to decrease the levels of testosterone? There are two methods. One is medical castration and another is surgical castration. The surgical is simple and very effective method to perform is bilateral orchidectomy. It is also called as bilateral subcapsular orchidectomy. But the problem is this will permanently interfere with the sexual activity. So usually it is accepted only by a very old patient. The next more acceptable choice is a medical castration. That means decreasing the testosterone level with the help of a medical agent. Here the testosterone levels are decreased using various pharmacological agents. Agents which oppose action of testosterone like diethylstilbestrol, phosphorylated diethylstilbestrol, or Eucan agents which will decrease the secretion of testosterone by inhibiting the pituitary hormone, luteinizing hormone releasing hormone. So you will be blocking LHRH, which is responsible for stimulating the lytic cell which are secreting the testosterone. The examples of the LHRH inhibitors are goserelin and leuprolide. Now, some patients with advanced disease and distant metastasis can be given whole body radiation to reduce the symptom. Patient with bony pain and visceral pain can be palliatively treated with the injection of a intravenous radiopharmaceuticals containing radioisotope strontium-89. Summary of the management of CA prostate. For incidentally diagnosed T1A and T1B tumors undergone TURP, put them under surveillance with DRE, PSA and TRUS. If recurrence occur, consider radiation for a patient who are more than age of 70. For the younger patient, consider radical prostatectomy or those patients diagnosed with a localized T1C or T2C tumors, that is localized or early carcinoma, consider radiation for patient more than age of 70. For younger and fitter patient, consider radical prostatectomy or radiation, of course followed by surveillance. For locally advanced T3 and T4 tumors, go for medical or surgical androgen ablation or deprivation. And for metastatic disease, you can go for again medical or surgical androgen ablation or deprivation with the general. So here we end, or this is the general outline of the management of carcinoma of prostate. In the same session, we are going to start with the testicular, but I will close this chapter here and you will have to go for another video that will be started for the topic of the testes. Thank you. Hello everyone, this is Dr. Dandekar. This lecture is meant for the present batch of 3rd-4th, and let us today discuss some basic surgical diseases related to the. The objective of this session are to describe the embryological descent of testes, Discuss the abnormalities related to the maldescent of testes. Discuss surgical anatomy of testes. Discuss the schedule of descent of testes. Describe the pathophysiology of undescended testes or incompletely descended testes. Discuss the complications of undescended or incompletely descended testes. And discuss the changes in an undescended or incompletely descended testes. The possible long answer question, as shown here, is: describe the embryology, clinical feature, diagnosis, and management of undescended or incompletely descended testes. The short notes may be asked on: describe the embryological descent of testes, abnormalities related to the maldescent of testes, surgical anatomy of testes, the thermoregulation of testes, schedule of descent of testes, clinical features of undescended or incompletely descended testes, diagnosis of incompletely descended testes, complications of undescended or incompletely descended testes, changes in the undescended testes, treatment of incompletely descended testes. Let us discuss the brief outline of the embryology of testes. The embryological testes develop from genital fold, which lies medial to the mesonephros in the developing embryo. The primitive testes originate at the level of T10 to T12 segment retroperitoneally. These primitive testes are attached to the posterior abdominal wall by a structure called as mesorchium. This mesorchium starts disappearing by 10th intrauterine week. Now you will come across two important terminology. The first is gubernacula. This is considered as a guiding force, rudder, or a precursor of descent of testes. It is represented by a cord which can be traced from the developing testes to the developing scrotum. There are two schools of thought how the gubernaculum works. First, that the gubernaculum acts as a rudder which guides the descent of testes to the scrotum. Another school of thought says that this cord, which is present from its origin to the scrotum, over the period slowly contracts, thereby pulling the testes to the scrotum. Now the next important terminology is processus vaginalis. This is a fold of peritoneum that protrudes down the inguinal canal into the scrotum, forming a patent canal. How it is formed? The testes at beginning are retroperitoneal. Then they start descending along the posterior wall to come and lie near the deep inguinal ring. Now, while entering into the inguinal canal, the testes on each side carries a fold of peritoneum along with it into the inguinal canal down to the bottom of scrotum. This outpouching of the peritoneum, which is patent, is known as processus vaginalis. At the time of birth, it should get obliterated. This diagram explains how the testes pulls with it the fold of peritoneum with it during the descent. And if you notice, actually the testes are outside this fold, but the testes are pulling this peritoneum, thereby establishing a connection of a scrotum to the peritoneum, but this will get obliterated at the time of. It is now important to know the schedule of descent of testes. At the second month of intrauterine life, they are at lumbar region. By the third month, they reach iliac fossae. At the 4th to the 6th intrauterine month, they reach the deep inguinal ring. By the 7th month, they enter into the inguinal canal. In the 8th month, they will reach the superficial inguinal ring, and at the time of birth, that is at the end of the ninth month of intrauterine life, the testis should be present in the scrotum. Let us see the structure of the testis in a brief. Each testis is made up of 200 to 300 lobules. Each lobule has 2 to 3 seminiferous tubules. Each seminiferous tubule contains cells in the different stages of spermatogenesis. Among the seminiferous tubule lies the Sertoli cells. And between the loops of seminiferous tubules, there are interstitial cells known as leading cells that produce testosterone. The seminiferous tubules join to form 20 to 30 straight tubules at the structure called rete testis. This rete testis is a network of tubule located in the hilum of the testicle that carries the sperm from the seminiferous tubules to the efferent duct. Rete testis give rise to 12 to 30 efferent ductules. Now there is one more important structure called epididymis, which lies or almost adherent to the kidney, to the testis, that is epididymis. Actually, it's a coil tube which is 20 feet, almost 6 meter long, coiled on the posterior surface of each testis and connect the efferent duct to the vas deferens. Let us see the arterial supply. The testicular artery is a branch of abdominal aorta. The reason is clear, because the origin of this testis lies near the T10 and T12, so it directly draws its blood supply from the aorta. Later, as it descends down, it carries the same blood supply while it reaches the scrotum. In addition, so the testicular artery is a branch of abdominal aorta, and the testis also has a collateral blood supply from the cremastric artery as well as the arteries to the ductus deferens. The venous drainage: the veins emerge from the back of the testis and receive tributaries from the epididymis. They unite and form a convoluted plexus called as pampiniform plexus. This plexus forms a single vein which opens on the right side. On the right side, it opens into the inferior vena cava, while the left testis will drain into the left renal vein. Read this anatomy of pampiniform plexus in detail, because you will have to understand the pathogenesis of varicocele. Now the lymphatics of testes drains into the retroperitoneal lymph nodes between the level of T1 and between the levels of T11 and L4. But they are concentrated more at the level of L1 and L3 vertebrae. Lymph nodes which are located lateral or anterior to the inferior vena cava are called paracaval or precaval nodes respectively. You can see the diagram. Here the arrow option is not working, that's why I am not able to show you in the diagram, but you can see the diagram very clearly. The interaortocaval nodes are located between the inferior vena cava and the aorta. Nodes anterior or lateral to the aorta are preaortic or paraaortic node respectively. This is a schematic diagram which you are aware is important for theoretical as well as a practical purpose. This diagram helps in understanding the covering of testes, as well as you will also have to describe the coverings while you are describing a inguinal scrotal hernia. With this brief embryological and anatomical background, let us consider the first surgical condition called incompletely descended testes. This condition is also described as the undescended testes. There is a slight technical difference between these undescended testes and an incompletely descended testes. But for practical purpose, or if it is, because some people will ask you the short note as incompletely descended testes, or some can also ask as a undescended testes, you are supposed to describe the same condition. Incompletely descended testes means when the testes is arrested at some point in its normal path while going to the bottom of scrotum. In other words, it is a failure of testes to descend or get retained at any point in the normal path of descent. Thus, the incompletely descended testes could be present at lumbar level, at iliac fossae, at the deep ring, in the inguinal canal, at the superficial ring, or halfway into the scrotum, but not reach the bottom of scrotum. So they have not deviated from the normal path of descent. Technically, the undescended testes denote the testes which has stuck to the place of origin. That means the lumbar testes will be called as a undescended testes because they have not been able to descend down. While an ectopic testes is a testes that has traveled to an abnormal place outside the normal path. What are the factors responsible for the normal descent? You have to know what causes the descent, because see, this is a very tedious journey. Something which arises at the T10 to T12 level, and it has to travel through the abdominal cavity, enter into the inguinal canal, which is oblique, and finally enter into the scrotum. So there has to be some mechanism which will contribute to the descent of the testes. So hormonal effect, one of the factors that is responsible is hormonal effect, that is a maternal chorionic gonadotropin. Next is shortening and active contraction of gubernaculum. So it is very well accepted that the gubernaculum, either because it's a guiding force, a rudder, or it is a contracting cord, whatever, but the role of gubernaculum is very much important in the descent of the testes. Increased abdominal pressure. The abdominal organs from the liver to the intestine, they are growing rapidly and they occupy the abdominal cavity, thereby creating a pressure that helps the testes to descend downward. Active contraction of the lower fibers of internal oblique muscle is supposed to help in squeezing the testes downward through the inguinal canal. Now remember, here in adult, what you observe is the oblique inguinal canal. There is at least 4 cm gap between the superficial and the deep ring. But in the embryonic life, this superficial ring as well as the deep ring are almost overlying or overlapping upon each other. So it is not that oblique pathway. Later it becomes oblique and elongated. Also, the higher temperature in the abdominal cavity is a stimulus which pushes the testes to seek its destined position, that is in the scrotum, because the scrotal temperature is lower than the intra-abdominal temperature. Then what can cause the mal descent? What are the factors which will prevent the descent of testes? Probably abnormality of gubernaculum. If the functioning of gubernaculum is not proper, and that will arrest the descent of the testes. Then intrinsic testicular defect. That means if the shape or size of the testis is not normal, suppose it is small or it is large, so that will interfere with the descent of testis. One more factor consider is that, as we have seen, that there is a structure that is called a mesorchium by which the testes are attached to the posterior wall, and by the 10th intrauterine life this mesorchium starts disappearing. But suppose it doesn't disappear properly, then it might interfere. Or another factor could be possibly if the testes are adhered to the surrounding structure. One more factor, that if the testes are normal, if the gubernaculum is normal, everything is normal, but the development of vas deferens is not proper, so that will also automatically arrest the descent of the testes. Similarly, if the testicular artery or the pampiniform plexus, if they are short, so that way they will also interfere with the descent of the testes. Let us see the incidence. The probability of this condition is about 4% boys are born with one or both testes incompletely descended. Of that, 2/3 reach the scrotum by first 3 months of life, but full descent after that is uncommon. The incidence of testicular maldescent at the age of 1 year is around 1%. And some are detected in lateral life with the presence of hernia, testicular pain, acute torsion, infertility, or with pregnancy. 50% are presented of the incompletely tested, 50% are present on the right side, 30% are present on the left side, and this condition is bilateral in almost 20% of. What is the problem? If the testes are not brought down to the scrotum, then the problem is it will undergo certain morphological changes. Up to the age of 6, the testes may remain normal. At puberty, they become poorly developed and feel flabby to touch. And by the age of 16, there are irreversible destructive changes with a halted spermatogenesis. The testicular size and the growth will be affected. The spermatogenesis is affected because testes are exposed to the higher temperature. That might result in infertility, and the secretory function may be affected. The secondary sexual character may remain normal because the functioning of the leading cell is partially intact even at higher temperature. And also one more thing is note that the impotence is very rare. Trauma is common as the normal protective mechanism of scrotum is not available for the testes. For the same reason, torsion is common. The incompletely descended testes are commonly associated with the congenital hernia because the abnormal descent, the processus vaginalis may not close. Thus, the chances of congenital hernia are higher. The most dangerous effect of maldescent is exposure to abnormal temperature that increases the malignancy potential to a very high level. That is, chances of malignancy in inguinal testes is 1 in 80, while it becomes 1 in 20 for the abdominal testes. The types of incompletely descended testes will depend upon the site where the testicular descent is arrested. So, lumbar testes is a complete failure descent. These are extraperitoneal testes. And technically, you can call this as an undescended testes. Iliac testes are intra-abdominal. Then they can lie at the inside the abdomen at the deep inguinal ring. Then in the inguinal canal. You can find an incompletely descended at the superficial ring. Then you can find a scrotal testis in the upper part, that is the root of the scrotum. But remember, before you label a testis as incompletely descended, which are situated from the inguinal canal downward, do not forget to rule out a condition that is called as retractile testis. Now it is very essential that incompletely descended testis should be detected at the earliest. When you are examining a child, always expose the scrotum. Many times you will notice an ill-developed scrotum, unilateral or bilateral, and the most of the time the condition is bilateral. Early diagnosis in children is common when the childbirth is attended by a neonatologist or the doctor. The latter diagnosis are usually done by parents, or the children can be detected of having an incompletely descended testis at school health examination. Sometimes the patient who are young and present with a hernia are usually noted to have incompletely descended testis. It may present sometimes with a trauma, as a torsion, or as a lump. In addition, you may come across the adult patient presenting with infertility in their adulthood. Some or unfortunate cases may present with a malignancy associated with an incompletely descended testis. So let us enlist here a list of complications associated with the incompletely descended testis. Torsion, atrophy of testis, associated hernia complication, sterility, pain, epididymorchitis, malignancy. So it becomes essential, actually the diagnosis is very simple. The absence of testis in the scrotum will directly lead you to a suspicion of an incompletely descended testis. So how you will diagnose this condition? Simple physical examination is important. Examine the scrotum for absence of single or both testes in the scrotum. If absent in the scrotum, palpate up to the deep ring. Testes may be present at the root of scrotum or at the superficial ring. Most of the times in these two types, the testes are almost normal. Above the deep ring, it is difficult to physically palpate the undescended or incompletely descended testis. The canalicular testis may be palpated with a difficulty as a soft flabby mass. Sometimes all you get is the tenderness, and below that tenderness you can notice a testis with the help of investigation like ultrasound. Clinical diagnosis needs to be confirmed and documented. So in children, USG will give you all details of placement, size and shape of scrotal as well as canalicular testes. So USG is very helpful up to the level of deep ring. For higher testes, CT or MRI may be necessary. In adult patient who are coming in the late stage, the same is followed. You can go for a CT, USG, CT and MRI. So the similar workout is to be done, but in addition you will have to go for semen analysis and tumor marker if the patient is presenting very late. But still, a baseline tumor marker is always welcome. So let us discuss here the treatment. If the patient is presented at birth with a confirmed diagnosis of incompletely descended testis, this option is only for selected cases. Remember, this is not for all. The decision of hormone therapy is usually taken in consultation with the endocrinologist. Hormone therapy is indicated in patients with hypogonadism and hypogenitalism. If this patient have and the endocrinologist agrees, then you can start your treatment with a chorionic gonadotropin 5000 international unit intramuscular daily for 5 days. Or you can start with a oral methyl testosterone in the dose of 5 mg per kg per day for 1 month. If the patient is having, so other than these patient, coming to the normal patient who have presented with a normal testes, apparently normal testes stuck at the higher level. So for this patient, the gold standard treatment is orchidopexy or orchiopexy. Orchidopexy or orchiopexy means mobilizing and bringing down the testes and fixing it at the bottom of scrotum. The ideal of age of the operation is the patient should be operated before the boy completes 1 year of age. But orchidopexy is also done as a standard procedure whenever the boy presents at any age before puberty. So we get this kind of patient. Patient comes before puberty and these patients are to be posted for the orchiopexy. If the testes is easy to mobilize down, then a single stage may suffice. But if there are some problems, like if the pedicles are small, if the vas deferens is small, then the same thing you might have to do in a multiple stages. If the patient comes late, then the treatment of the undescended or the incompletely descended testes becomes tricky. The patient who are presenting during adulthood, infertility or with a somatosexual problem. Here are some problems to consider. High malignancy potential, because if the testes remains at higher level, I said there are chances of conversion to the malignancy. For inguinal testes, it is 1 in 80. For abdominal testes, it is 1 in 20. So that is a problem you must have to consider. Next is the changes are not reversible if the procedure is done after 6 years. That means the patient comes late and the changes are already established. Then there is no point in, so you will not get the desired effect. If the patient is coming with an infertility complaint and at the age of say after 20 or 22 or during any adult age, if you bring the testes down even easily, still the changes are permanent. It is not going to improve the infertility. Also, you cannot straight ahead with the chopping of the testes because their presence is important for testosterone secretion, for maintenance of potency, male contour, male character and secondary sexual character. So actually this is a, there will be a sort of ethical problem that at one point you have a risk of malignancy and another point if the patient, see actually the problem is easy when the patient having one normal testes and another abnormal testes. Abnormal means undescended testes or incompletely descended testes. That one testes which is normal is more than sufficient for all his requirement of a potency, fertility, male contour and everything. But if both the testes are incompletely descended, then there is a lot of ethical problem. Because if you chop them, it will result into the potency. There will be a loss of testosterone secretion, so the male characteristics will be lost. So that you have to think it very, very carefully. So this is one of the problem where you have to think of the ethics. So what you do is that in the late presentation, first thing is that the patient needs to be counseled and explain about the outcome. Again, think about the ethics. If the testes is unilateral, if it is rudimentary, if there is no use and if it is at a higher level, in that case, you don't have a choice and straight go ahead with an orchidectomy. If it is near the inguinal ring with a possibility of mobilize, then it can be brought down to a level where you can watch it. So you are not bringing down for any use, but you are bringing it in the vision so you can follow it. You can continue follow by observing it. If there is any change, you will observe, or the patient will notice. So the patient who are highly compliant, who are intelligent and come for follow, these can be best treated with this option. So that is the treatment of the incompletely descended testis. Now I have added few next slides. These are the broad steps that will show you the orchidectomy. That is just for additional information. So you can go through this slides. You can pause it and see. That is all. Thank you very much.